to this talk with All About Architecture. In today's session, we are just going to have a couple of questions with your new product, which seems at times like magic, which seems very unbelievable to most people. So, and there's also this thing where we find designers coming up with new products and products made out of pollution as a very unbelievable fact. So I would like you to take this session and explain us how your journey has been and what it is about. So my first question to you is, as a design studio, what prompted you to innovate a new material?
Hi, Sairi. Thank you for having me. I think starting with what you said, is it really magic? Is it really what people feel it is? So to answer probably that question before we get into the question answer, as humans, we believe in things only that we can see. If something we don't see, we don't really believe in it. That's something that goes with air pollution as a larger context, I would say. Not a lot of people really understand the impact of air pollution because they don't see it, maybe. To give a fact around COVID itself that we see right now, the COVID virus is 20 times smaller than the PM2.5 particles. So if the COVID can create that kind of damage being invisible, our PM particles are very well sort of capable to create that kind of impact. Moving on to the question that you're really asking, and I think that is where it starts from. When we wanted to work with three research agendas at that time that we started to look at. One is clean air, clean water, and clean food. And while we started to do some initial research in which area should we really pick for that year, and we realized that clean air is something which is extremely neglected in a way, and it's a global phenomenon. And we need to sort of work with this. As an architect, we realize that 39% of the energy-related carbon emissions are due to the building and construction industry, and that was humongous. As an architect by profession itself, we realize that it's a probably more ethical standpoint that we are responsible for whatever we are building, and we need to sort of get it right from either the manufacturing product perspective or from the construction industry perspective. So if you're able to make even 1% change in terms of impact, I think you'll be able to create a larger impact on this. I think that prompted us to sort of move into looking at materials as well overall.
And how do we kind of end up with the product, and how is it made? So yeah.
We didn't really land up into tiles. I wouldn't say that one fine day we woke up and we decided that let's make tiles. No, that's not how it really started. The story goes back to somewhere about 2016 when I was working on a visiting school. So I was directing the AA visiting school in 2016, and we wanted to work with the Costa Vino Bolt. We wanted to build a sort of a double curve vault using bricks in a way. And that's when I had seen Gravicky's video around Eric, and I had approached Anirudh with that, and we started to have an initial discussion, can we make bricks out of this? And we then learned a lot more with that context. How is it coming? What is the larger problem around this? Is there a supply chain issue? Is there a sourcing issue? So we started to understand a little bit around that, and then we realized that brick doesn't have any commercial value, right? It goes into a wall essentially. So once it goes into a wall, no one can see it. So no one wants to pay for it. In India, you get this red bricks for like 4 rupees. Who will pay a price for this entire sequestration of the carbon into this? So that became a sort of a failed experiment from there, and we then moved on to a facade. We thought that why don't we capture it ourselves. So we started to look at a facade which can capture and be built with the same emissions itself. So, or the particulate matter rather itself. So we started with that, and then we realized that it's not scalable in a way. So how many people really want to spend on a facade? It's not a necessity as such. It's not a product that people really want to buy and put. It's a luxury in a way. From there is when we thought that what is this basic element that we can build which goes into every house and people might want to pay for it. So there are two factors that really dealt in really choosing into a tile as a fact, which was, one is it needs to have a design element, which is the brick did not have, and then to move into a commercially scalable product, which is what the facade did not have. That's how we came down into making carbon tiles from that. So while we were choosing tiles, we also wanted to make sure that the carbon emissions of making this tile itself is lower. So that's why we chose a technique which is using a hydraulic press, which is in a way 1/5 of the energy which is required to manufacture any mass produced vitrified tile or conventional tile. So that's where we started to work with this old craftsman who had this sort of a technique, very interesting technique that uses this craft, which is sort of transferred as a skill from one generation to the other. And when we met them, we knew that this has lower carbon emissions, this has lower impact, it has social empowerment as well in a way, and it's going to work within the segment that we are in. So although it has its own issues as well, I wouldn't say that it doesn't have its limitations. But we thought that that's a very exciting starting point, and that's how we came about building carbon tiles around this. So in terms of carbon tiles itself, so there are two points into this. One is with respect to the raw material, and the other one is how do you manufacture this, essentially. So in the first part of it, we are collaborating with Airink. So they help us capture, collect, and process the carbon emissions. And then we sort of use this emission to sort of work with as a base for material innovation. We mix it with marble chips and other industrial byproducts. And we have our own sort of recipe around that, and then we manufacture this with the craftsman basically. So that is where we say that there is an old sort of traditional way of making, and then there is this new technique, and then we fuse it, and then we sort of tackle this global issue of climate change.